And the operator is also going to have to pass this aeronautical knowledge and safety test, very similar to what they have to do for the Part 107. So hobbyists aren't necessarily happy with this. I've never been a hobbyist, so I've always, you know, had to do a Part 107, so I'm not as upset about it. But I can kind of see why the hobbyists have kind of been, you know, the role models out there, the good advocates through AMA. And so they're a little upset, but I can understand why. And so the thing that makes me excited about it, though, is we have this beyond visual line of sight. So we have not been able to operate beyond visual line of sight before. And so with these new rules that are be putting in place, we're going to be able to examine nighttime operations, operations over people. The one I'm really excited about is operation of multiple unmanned aircraft. So if we had three or four that we could line up and go in one straight line, we could cover a much larger swath of land and do much larger areas using multi-rotor aircraft. So that makes me excited about that. There's also unmanned air traffic test ranges that are now being put in place. And this afternoon, I'm actually going to Tooele. Tooele, they're opening experience center is what they're calling it. The company's Deseret UAS, where we can go out there, test our drones. They're going to have their own COA, so we could fly over 400 feet and test a little bit higher altitudes type of operations to cover more ground. So I'll be excited to go back to that and report back to you guys what we find out there. So with all this fun, obviously there's some privacy that was built into this bill as well. So they are asking us that to now have a written privacy policy consistent with Section 357 that is appropriate to the nature and scope of the activities regarding the collection, use, retention, dissemination, and deletion of any data collected during the operation of the unmanned aircraft system. So we're in the process of putting together this privacy policy. We need to make it public and put it on our website. And so we will try to be as transparent as possible when we're out operating these drones. And we will review it and update it as necessary. I think it would be an annual review and update type of privacy policy. So not only the policies do we need to keep up, we keep getting these memos as well. So they want us to start using these reflective orange vests, a lot like you board members have to wear when you go out on the board field trip and go on construction sites. And so the reason for that is some of the operations, some public think if it's threatening, they're worried about safety. And so they're saying these pilots aren't easily identifiable. And so the FAA is asking us to be more identifiable and have a visual observer that can kind of intercept these people that come and ask us questions when we're flying, so that way we're not distracted as we fly the drone. And so they're putting in these information for operators memos. And so we have to keep up with that type of policy as well. There's multiple different policies across different states. So this one's from Kentucky. This judge dismissed this man who shot down a drone that was flying over his backyard. He said, "My daughter's sunbathing, and the drone comes over, and I shot it out of the sky." And the judge says, "Well, we're not sure what to do with this." The drone operator said, "Well, my GPS says I was right here." Well, there's an inherent error in GPS units, and so the judge says, "We're not quite sure, you know, if this is a 5-meter error, 10-meter error. We can't tell exactly where you were in terms of this process." So the evidence, using drone data for evidentiary purposes, is going through these because of incidents like this. Here's an Oregon man who's facing felony charges for shooting a drone out of the sky. And so, unlike the guy in Kentucky who got his charges dropped, this guy has got a Class C felony, $10,000 fine, up to a year in jail for shooting down a $1,000 aircraft. So it's very interesting to see the different policies across the different states, and so we're trying to keep up with some of those policies. I have a quick little video I want to show you of these criminals out there. So I'll kind of talk through this and narrate it. So obviously his privacy is being invaded here, and it does not like the drone hovering over the top of it. But should this cat be fined $10,000 for taking the drone out of the sky? I don't quite think so. I would never advocate for taking drones out of the sky, but here we have TP, or toilet paper, as an excellent anti-drone weapon and a good arm. And for some reason, the toilet paper wraps up into the props, takes it out of the sky. And so, very unique way of taking a drone out of the sky. And some people, before the drone even goes over their property, he's like, hey, you're gonna fly this over my house? I'm gonna be upset if you do that. Well, he doesn't even let the opportunity arise. He just knocks it out of the sky. And so we're just like, well, maybe some people deserve a $10,000 fine because this guy clearly wasn't doing anything improper. And then these firefighters, right, they're out there fighting fires, and we have this in Utah. Well, this guy's, you know, clearly being distracted from his job, and he's taking the drone out. And so he should be fined $10,000. So here we have, you know, like I said, visual observers are needed. We have a guy flying over a beach. There's not a whole lot of people there, but this girl is going after him because she feels like, hey, I'm going to go lay out. So this is a bunch of, you know, monkey business taking care of this. I kind of make a joke on this one. If stupidity was a crime, never let your drone's battery die while you're over a body of water. It goes into auto land mode, and it doesn't care what it's going to land in. This guy probably should have lost his drone, in my opinion. You should know where it's going to land. But it doesn't take just flying over a lake, as you can see here. A little strip of water. Looks pretty cold, but this guy's dedicated. He saves his drone. I was like, oh, maybe you should have lost it. You always have a backup plan. Here, this arrow is pointing to the drone operator, and here he makes the mad dash. He sees his drone going into auto land. And I always point out to drone operators, please do not put yourself in precarious situations trying to save a $100 drone. If that wave was any larger right there, it could have wiped him off of those rocks. And so knowing when to say not to go save your drone is also very important. So the state policies, like we were mentioning, they override some of these federal policies. In Utah, Legislative General Council, they have passed a bill that permits these public safety officials to neutralize these unmanned aircraft systems when it's in response or interference to emergencies. So like the fires that we're seeing these drones go around, law enforcement now has the authorization to take them out of the sky, which I think is a very valuable piece of legislation. So. And then we've put together our own drone policy. Like I told you before, when you go in and take your drone pilot test, you just do a written portion. I don't know if I necessarily feel comfortable with staff coming on saying, hey, I've never, you know, flown a drone before, but I passed my Part 107. Can I fly your guys' $13,000 drone? And I'm going to say no. You've never driven a car. I wouldn't trust you driving my Ferrari around. And so we put into our own policy that someone has to have 10 hours of stick time. They would be monitored with me. I would be their remote pilot in command. I would train them and ensure that they had the proper training to operate this system. So that's the policy. That's all the, you know, sexy stuff you guys like, but here's the stuff I love, the data that we get from this drone. So here's the aerial inspections. This is the M210 RTK. This is the drone that we currently have. This is a different camera combination. So we can fly with the camera on top, we can fly with one on the bottom, or we can fly with two on the bottom. And these little sensors up on the top are the RTK. So that's a real-time kinematic GPS system, which means we're getting centimeter grade accuracy with this drone. And it's survey grade data. So I want to show you guys the autopilot software that we're using. This is the Universal Ground Control Station, or UGCS. So basically, we give the drone a home point, we give it the flight plan, and this graph you're seeing, the green line, that's the drone flying over the terrain, ensuring that it stays 100 feet below above the ground. The reason for this is we're operating in a military operational area, so there's, you know, F-35s out there operating at 400, 500 feet for training purposes, and if I were to have a collision with one of those, my boss would fire me, or I would see it coming and I'd be like, I quit, right there on the spot. But as you can see here, the drone is flying this grid pattern, and in this grid pattern is what we're doing is taking images every 3 seconds. And you can see up here in the top right, as the battery voltage goes down, it hits 30%, goes red, and then I can hit return to home, change the battery, and then relaunch it with a new start point, and that's indicated by these flags right here. So in this flight, we took roughly 1,900 images, and then we mosaic those together, and that's what gives us what we call an ortho map, and that's a 2D map. But the nice thing about this drone is when we fly a double grid mission like this, we get 3D data, and that 3D data allows us to do volumetrics analysis, hydrological analysis, and it's pretty impressive data that we get off of that. So let me go back into the presentation. So We are also using LIDAR technology. That's light detection and ranging. I'm not sure if you guys are very familiar with that, but essentially a laser comes out, shoots, detects the matter that it's picked up, and then ranges it and says this is how tall or far away from the sensor it is. And so you can kind of see that from this diagram on the right, shoots out a laser pulse, comes down, and it gets a crown return from the top of this tree, and it creates a point. We call it discrete record. Then we get the understory return, which would be these little shrubs at the bottom, and then we get a ground return, which is flat and it wouldn't come back. And so we would basically get this data so we can do fine sediment monitoring and biomass calculations. We're doing a pocking research project with Utah State University. We actually got a public lands grant with Utah State University. This is a grant that basically gives us a graduate student to work with, and we are currently in the process of that, and I can show you some of the data that we've collected so far of the Cottonwood Wilberg mine. And so, Mr. Hansen, you've seen this video before, so I apologize if this is a repeat. You can take a nap now. But we're using Global Mapper software to process a lot of our drone imagery, and what I'm doing right here is actually drawing a transect line and getting in point cloud data within that pink area. So that point cloud basically is what we're doing, is getting a lot of these points. You can see the trees, you can see each individual branch. So the laser shooting through all these branches and then gets the surface, and then is what we do is take the vegetation off and we have a surface model is what we call it. And then we can get biomass calculations with the stuff we've taken off, and then we can watch the fine sediment move across the terrain. So right here, this is the 3D model I was talking to you guys about. This is before we started doing the reclamation progress. It is pretty high accuracy, high detailed data. And what we've done here is basically made a digital surface model. And that surface model, like I've explained to you, we take off the vegetation, and we just get the sediment, and we monitor the sediment across this landscape. And pocking, if you guys aren't very familiar with pocking, it basically is a revegetation, reclamation kind of project. So down here, let me pause this video. We have a couple of sediment ponds, these retention ponds. And so pocking, the idea behind it is we will not have to use these retention ponds because the sediment will be captured in these irregular divots. So they're 24 to 48 inches dug by a track hoe. And they go through and just kind of scoop out the landscape. And I'll show you that data right here. And the idea behind that is that the sediment will fall into the pocks instead of needing that retention pond down at the bottom. And it also retains some of the water. And so we're hoping that water will act as a good source for these seeds that we put on there, for the grass seed that we spread, so they can take root. And so here's the pocks. They're a bunch of irregular holes. And as you can kind of see, there's like water that are, you know, it looks like water. But the idea is that those pocks will retain the water seed and replace needing these sediment ponds. So let me close this down real quick. And the Kenilworth project, this is one of my favorite projects I've been working on so far. It's a coal reclamation project. It's a large project of $2 million that have been put towards this. We're using drones to kind of monitor the progress and to look at the erosion damage that had occurred. So here's a quick little video of the mine reclamation site. And we're hoping that with these videos, we can kind of bring board members out to the field site to some of these areas that maybe you're not able to make it to. We can do updates with our project managers and say, this is where we're at. So here you can clearly see where there's been tons of erosion that has occurred. And this black stuff you see on the side is the coal that has been, that refuse that's been covered up. This is a drop structure that has clearly been eroded away. You can see that geotech flapping in the wind. Some of the cool technology behind this drone is it's got obstacle avoidance sensors, so I can see these little red flashes on my screen as I come by this terrain, and it actually helps me avoid the obstacles. It doesn't do very good around the trees, hence why I pull out and get away from the tree while I operate. And then you can kind of see, you know, the erosion that's occurred here. And what I'm doing right here is circling this area to measure the amount of material that has slumped off. And right here we have 833 cubic yards that has eroded and slumped off. And there's a little culvert right here where the water is, you know, kind of draining in and over saturating that area. And with the hydrological analysis, we actually found that the water was running down this road right here, running through that culvert, oversaturating this hill slope, and causing it to slump and erode. So here's the mine reclamation in progress. When the boss shows up with the drone, I guess everyone works a lot faster. So that's pretty nice. So no one sits around, kind of funny thing. So, but it was cool to go out there and actually see some of this work that was taking place. And then here you can see, you know, dust mitigation taking place. We like to get evidence of that because that's one of the biggest complaints we get during mine operations and reclamation operation. And here you can see that they've put a gradual slope onto this landscape. And it's nice to have a visual observer, so that way if you ever have, you know, heavy equipment or construction workers that want to run your drone over, you can see them hit the gas right there. And then they say, hey, get out of the way, pull it up. So this was in July 2018, this is midsummer, and we went out again in August, and so here's some of the footage of the check dam structures that have been put in place. You can see the coal that's being covered up with the topsoil, and you can see the work that's being done. This guy's compacting this hill slope, very steep hill slopes. I didn't realize that they needed to be compacted quite this way, but I wasn't sure if it was the drone coming out when he said, hey, I'm gonna start compacting the steepest hill slope we have here with our tractor, but it was an amazing shot. What they do is no joke. Their jobs are scary. It's impressive what they do out there, and it's nice to come out and see what they're doing. This video, we're currently still editing. We're still working on it. We're hoping that we can kind of put this video out in the next governor's report Holly Brown is putting together. And so, great work done by these guys. And then finally, the Tooele County five-mile pass. There's a lot of abandoned mines out there, and they're very hazardous to recreationalists out there, and wildland firefighters and the public in general. And so we worked with Utah State Parks to go out there. They gave us an intern and a four-wheeler to chase around with a drone. I think that was the highlight of the intern's job, was being chased by a drone. But it's very serious, and it was great that we have drones to help us tell the story. Like I've showed you mapping and analysis before, but we're using it to also tell stories. So here is, a closed graded mine. And so we use this 3D model to kind of show this is what a graded mine closure looks like. And we give a little information tidbits with these. Did you know that there's, you know, these could be hundreds or even thousands of feet deep. They're spread across the landscape. Here's our intern just having a good time being chased around by the drone. But some of these shots that these drones get us, we just cannot get from the ground. Like when he comes up onto this hole and hits the brakes and we pull the drone over the top, we realize that this hole is the size of that four-wheeler and is much more of a storyteller than we could be with our words writing it down. And so this has really helped us out a lot in doing storytelling. And there's some closures that are kind of unique. We don't do a lot of puff polyurethane plug and backfilling, and so it's kind of important for us to kind of document when these unique mine closures will be put in place. So here we have a diagram. You can see the bottom form. There's 22 feet of puff or polyurethane foam, and then you have a foot of concrete, and then you backfill and grade. And so that's basically what we're seeing here. It was also we worked with the Utah Correctional Industries. It was great to work with some of these inmates out there. They're getting construction experience when we go out there and hire them. So when they get out, they can have some jobs that they can apply for and have some experience. So here's them pouring that puff in there. And puff is really just that, if you've sprayed insulation foam into your house, it's very similar to that. Here you can see them putting down the base for that concrete cap. And then you can see them backfilling and regrading this hole. And you can tell these guys are confident in the work because they drive the skid steer and their mini track hoe on top of it, and it does not collapse. I was like, oh, I don't know if I would drive on top of that. But they're very confident in their work. They do great work. And it's very important for us to put together these videos to explain why our programs are here and how we are protecting the public with these programs. So with that, any questions?
Board members, any questions?
Do you know that mine shaft was there before you did the drone video?
Yeah, I would let these guys answer that. I was just on for about a month at that point, and so I'm not very familiar with that.
Yes, this was actually the shaft that ATV rider fell in. We did know about it, but we took the opportunity to do this video while we were doing the work. But we did the work based on that accident.
Your mic's not on.
Yeah, so how did that accident turn out?
Miraculously, the guy, I think he had some minor injuries, maybe some broken bones, but he was fine.
He was able to get back out of it, or he had...
He was camping with friends, and I believe they found him. They search and rescue had to go. You can find the story on KSL, and you can see the work that the search and rescue people had to do to get him out, but he luckily didn't have any major injuries, and... obviously, we closed that as quickly as we could because it was really close to the trail. He was driving around at 4 o'clock in the morning, so I don't know that probably contributed to it. I'm not going to blame the victim, but that's why we have the abandoned mine reclamation program, is to close these things that could be of a hazard to someone that has no idea they're there.
I have a couple of questions. First of all, I want to say I applaud the use of drones. I think the technology is amazing. I think most progressive mining companies are using drones now to measure reserves and stockpiles and boundaries and things. I know we did, but the question I have for you is, does the state own the drone, or do we lease the drone from you, or how is it funded?
So the Division of Oil, Gas, and Mining owns this drone. We purchased it, and I would probably defer to our purchasing officer to have how she paid for it, or Dana might be able to tell you.
I won't pursue that further, Dana. That you don't need.
No, we have a technology budget, so we budget to replace computers on a frequent basis, so that we don't have people. You know, we don't wait till something breaks down, and then you have to wait 6 months to get something. So we used part of that computer budget this year. We had leftover money because we hadn't had to purchase as many computers as we thought we had. But the rate of return on this is going to be immeasurable. I mean, already our projects are more accurate. This project we're doing with the pawking to prove that it's not a new technology. It's something we've been using. If you go down Price Canyon and on the left, just as you're coming out of the canyon into the Helper area, the old Willow Creek mine, that was heavily pawked, and it looks great now. You could never tell that there was a mine there or that it was pawked. But the problem with that is the coal rules don't allow you to just pawk. They still say you have to leave a sedimentation pond in. We were able to do this Cottonwood Wilburg and take the ponds out, and with the understanding from the Office of Surface Mining that we would, it's an experimental practice, and we have to prove that it works better than leaving sedimentation ponds in and then going in and taking them out 2 years later. So this will pay for itself. Another thing that we're looking at is Pacific Corps told us that on that project, they underestimated how much dirt they had to move, and it was a substantial cost overrun. So I have asked Tommy over the next year, I know it's going to take him a while, he can't do everything in one day, to work with our mine operators and go out and make sure that we have accurate volumes right now, so that our bonds are based on accurate numbers, and just to verify things, because even Pacific Corps had no clue that that was going to be such a difference in the volume that needed to be moved. And so that will help us among the many other things that Tommy's doing. So I think it will pay for itself, but thankfully we do have a a technology budget that we were able to spend for this equipment this year. And we are borrowing some cameras from OSM and some other things, so it's kind of a combination of buying things and partnering with other agencies.
When we first started using drones, we were leasing the drones. We piled one up, and it cost about $25,000. So can they be insured? I mean, as much as you try and as good as you are, you can pile one up, and it's pretty expensive.
Very expensive. And the one you're seeing here is $13,000, and the two cameras on there are about $2,000 a piece. And so, yeah, you're saying, that goes fast. We've got them insured through risk management, and so the state's actually insured not only the drone but the sensors as well. And so it's a $1,000 deductible. We crash the drone, we pay $1,000, and they'll replace it as long as we have it inventoried with them. And so I've inventoried it, each one of the cameras as well. They will cover it even if it's damaged during transportation. So if we're just going somewhere, getting a car crash, something happens to it, we just pay that $1,000 and they'll replace it. And they consider the cameras part of the same package as the drone. And so it wouldn't be, you know, $1,000 for the camera, $1,000 for the drone. It would be $1,000 for the package. And so,
excellent. Thank you.
Yep.
Just what's your battery life?
The battery life on this one is depending on the cameras. So right here you see we have two cameras on there. It's about 25 minutes. I can go for about 35 minutes with one camera. There's some lightweight cameras that can get us up into the 40-minute range. And I've also can turn it on and give you guys a little show and tell if you guys would like to see it as well.
Please do.
All right. So when I turn it on, the cameras calibrate themselves. They do a little dance, is what we call it. So they basically level themselves out and smooth themselves out. I'll turn this on. You'll hear the beeps. That means it's happy and it's awake. We have a great relationship. And so I will plug this in so you guys can see up on your monitors what the drone is seeing itself. So plug this in here. So we are using the DJI app right here, just kind of show you guys what it looks like. We always have our checklist. You always want to put your return to home altitude. You want to calibrate your compass and IMU before you launch, so it always has its home point. So if I'm in St. George and I fly the drone, and then the next day I go up to Logan and fly the drone and I hit return to home, I don't want it to go to St. George. I want it to come down to home. So I recalibrate the compass every time before we fly. And so is what you're seeing is the X5S camera. So this is our mapping camera. And this mapping camera is a 20 megapixel camera. It's a micro four thirds sensor on there. So we get quite a bit of data out of it. And so you can see it moves independently, or I can lock these together. And I can move both of these cameras at the same time and focus them in. The nice thing that we have with this zoom camera, so this X5S is what we're looking at, and I can switch to the zoom camera by clicking onto this bottom right-hand screen. And now what we're looking through in the mainframe is the X30. So if we wanted to zoom into something, do I have any volunteers that would like to be have a really nice close-up?
Yeah, Susan volunteers.
Susan volunteers? All right. So I will shoot right over your guys' head, and we will look at the fire alarm. And even though I'm extremely zoomed in, you can see that I still have some very fine-tuned touches that I can do to my controller. And we can zoom into 30 times before we lose our optical zoom. And past 30, when that number goes blue, we're into the digital zoom. And the digital zoom will get us right into 180. And so it's a little touchy, but at that magnification, it's very impressive. And so if I wanted to, I could then switch back to this camera, and I could operate that one independently while maintaining that very close shot on that fire. And so then we'll zoom it back out, and this is basically the level that we would see with any standard camera. So, and then, does anyone want me to fly it around the room? Someone wants a haircut. Okay. So there's no props on here. I wouldn't fly it inside. I don't recommend it, but I would be happy to spool up the motors. And so this is what it sounds like with no props on there. And so it's a lot of fun. It's hard to call this work some days, but I stay up late, and I can tell you I work very hard on this stuff. And when you have multiple mine operators starting to line up, your work list gets longer. It turns from fun and play to work and dedication. So so anyway, that's the drone, and that's what it looks like. And those are the two cameras that we have. Like Dana pointed out, we are working with OSM. We're using this MicaSense Red Edge camera. It's for vegetation mapping, and we can tell the stress of plants with it. And we also have a thermal camera. It's the X-T2. That thermal camera is roughly the same cost as this drone, and so we are very careful with these. We've never had an incident, which I'm proud to say, knock on wood. And yeah, it's been a great platform, and I'm excited to get some of this thermal data collected and maybe give you guys a briefing a couple of months down the line of what data we've collected with it. So that's pretty much it.
I have one last question. Sorry.
Yeah, go ahead.
And we've talked on numerous occasions about our inability to inspect all of the mines that we have. Has there been any discussion about how drone technology might expedite inspections and allow us to get more of that done?
Yes, we've started talking about that. The thing is that we cannot do an inspection without a person being there, and we cannot, like Tommy said, he has to be in the line of sight of the drone. So, for example, at the Alton coal mine, Tommy's working with Priscilla and the operators down there to try to see more of the mine more quickly, because it is one of our larger disturbances in the coal program. And walking around and looking at all the topsoil piles would take a lot longer than Tommy flying them and then giving Priscilla the data or the photos, and she can look at those and other data. So, and we've also used it in our minerals program. And like I said, it won't prevent us from having to send someone to the mine. It can help us be more quick about that, or send one person and then have several people looking at the information back in the office. And you will see in future board hearings that we're using this to help you visualize what we're seeing and why we're bringing a problem to you at certain points in time. So we see it as a great tool for speeding up the process of inspections and being able to get to more sites in one day.
Mr. Moon?
Yeah, maybe more for John. What applications do you see for oil and gas?
Well, we've talked to things that are more spatial, like maybe spills, looking at during cleanups, and then also with our disposal facilities, as we're looking at those to get more of a current aerial view of what's going on there. And I think there's always things that could help with pre-sites if there's sensitive issues. So we've not moved in that direction yet, but I think there's something we could do, and we're working with Tommy, but the mining group seems to be using it more now, but that's 'cause it's more of an aerial dynamic.
Susan?
Could you give us a demonstration the next time the board is on site on one of our field trips?
Oh, yeah, absolutely. If that's something that you guys would like, I'm sure.
Absolutely.
Yeah, we could do that. Happy.
Thank you. Appreciate that. In the interest of time, anything else you want us to see?
No, that's it for me.
Okay. Then we're going to go to the next proposed next agenda item on the briefing session, which is the proposed board hearing schedule for 2019.
Okay, I believe you have a copy of this right now, the agenda and deadlines. We'd like you to take a look at that, review your schedules. If there's any issues, we'd like to finalize that by our next meeting. So take a look at that and be aware of it. Okay.
Thank you.
Also, I'd like to note that we had our October collaborative meeting in Duchesne on October 11th. I mean, Mr. Moon was there, and we focused on air quality. That's becoming a bigger issue out in the basin with it going into non-attainment. We had representatives from Division Air Quality, BLM, and also a professor from the Utah State University talk about the science of it. So really where we're at there is they're going to get 3 years from that point of non-attainment to try to pick things up, or then it'll go to the next step. So that's something very critical for the basin. So we focused on that in our collaborative meeting. As you know, our policy has been not to have a November board hearing, and so our next board meeting will be December 5th. Let me see here. You have your holiday open house will be the day before, December 4th from 3 to 5. So put that on your calendar. That's always a good event, and we appreciate that. With that, I don't have anything else unless you do. I'll turn the time over to you, Mr. Gill.
Thank you very much. Anything by the board members? And this is the time for public comment. If you have a matter that's within our jurisdiction and is also, we are welcoming discussions on policy and our general procedures. If there is something specific that deals with specific companies or specific operations, we'd like to make sure we give you the time to explain that to us. We only have a few minutes left today, and we'd like to schedule that for you. So is there anyone like to make a specific comment today, or pardon me, a general comment today concerning our operations or our policies? Seeing none, then we'll take a recess. And we'll be back as soon as the parties are set up. We will, I think we will start, we'll read in item number one, but I think we'll start with number two, agenda item number two for purposes of our hearing. It's also continued. Okay. Thank you. We'll be in recess.